Hello there, everybody. This is Mel Allen. Baseball sure is a sight to see. See this. Chicago's Tom Seaver sets his sights on a spectacular summit and steers his way to the magic circle of success. Capital C. California's Rod Carew slaps out a classic single that sends him soaring sky high into celebrated status. See him run. St. Louis Express Vince Coleman makes base stealing seem simple as he sets a standard with superior speed. Soft C. Houston's Jose Cruz, a solid standout who sparkles despite his understated stature. So stay tuned as we spotlight one and all on This Week in Baseball. American League hoopla. Let us now praise a preeminent pair who made history on the same day.
George Thomas Seaver. Two men are out. Seaver bidding for the 300th win of his career to become only the 17th man in the history of the game to reach 300. Tom Terrific is 40 years old. And it's a high fly ball. It should be playable. Nichols is moving over. Nichols is there. The ball game is over. Seaver has won 300. He has become the 17th man in the history of baseball to win 300 games.
Yankee Stadium provided an appropriate setting for Seaver's triumph because New York was where Tom Terrific made his debut 19 seasons ago with the Mets. Though now with the White Sox, no wonder Met fans came to the Bronx to join in hailing a man forever belonging in their hearts and minds.
Tom Seaver is the Mets and was the Mets, and one day will come back and have his number retired. Still root for him. All the Met fans who are loyal Met fans will come out and root for him. And Tom Seaver's number one.
Met fans have considered Seaver number one since he broke in at age 22 in 1967, becoming Rookie of the Year. And in his first two seasons, winning 32 games. Then in 1969, he went 25-7 to lead the league in wins and to lead his team to a miraculous finish against all odds as the Mets beat Baltimore in five games to win the World Series.
Fondest memory that I have in the game of baseball is World Championship year in 1969. When Cleon Jones caught that last out, that was, the team effort, the joy and the thrill that you get from a team effort, from everybody getting together and creating something is the best feeling that I've ever had in my professional career. You can only win for the first time once in your career, and I think that's a very special moment.
Who can forget when Seaver in 1970 struck out 19 Padres, the last 10 in a row? Most memorable, too, was a game against the Chicago Cubs during the Mets' historic pennant drive the year before. Seaver was too much to bear for the Cubs, who had yet to reach base through 8 1/3 innings. Then, with one out in the ninth, Jimmy Qualls blooped a single to spoil Seaver's bid for a perfect game.
It was a terrific moment. It was the only game my wife was in tears. I remember that my wife was in tears after the game, and I said, how in the world can you be sad in a game where you just... I pitched a one-hit shutout, didn't walk anybody, struck out 10, and we won 4-0, and it in the middle of a pennant race. And it was, it's a game certainly that I'll remember my entire life.
By 1977, Tom Terrific had won 20 games four times and the Cy Young Award three times, but found himself involved in a shocking midseason trade that sent the Mets' all-time winningest pitcher to Cincinnati. With the Reds, Seaver completed his fifth 20-win season. And then, on June 16, 1978, he beat St. Louis for the only no-hitter of his career.
The no-hitter that I had in Cincinnati was not, I don't think, one of my best games. And there was a game where you've heard it said before that every time they seemed to hit the ball hard, it was right at somebody. Joe Morgan made a great play. You figure if you have decent stuff at least one time in 19 years, you might pick up a no-hitter.
In the winter of 82, after his first losing season, Seaver was traded back to New York, where Met fans hailed their prodigal son on opening day of 83.
That was very touching, and I found that very warm. The reception that I got Very warm. That was a marvelous feeling. That was terrific.
But Seaver's second stint in New York was brief. The Mets failed to protect him in the compensation draft of 1984. He was claimed by the White Sox, and this year he'd won 11 games for a career total of 299 when he beat the Yankees at the stadium to become the 17th pitcher to win 300 games.
300 is not a destination point for me. My goal simply will be what they've always been, is to pitch well and pitch consistently well. I think that's the best thing. The best thing I can give my teammates, the best thing I can give my manager.
Terrific Tom Seaver. Now, let's move on to another future Hall of Famer.
Rodney Klein-Carew, the hitter extraordinaire, goes after number 3,000. There's a drive to left field, base hit. There's number 3,000 for Carew. So Carew has joined the illustrious 3,000 hit club.
3,000 for Rod Carew, and his teammates are coming out on the field to congratulate him.
No, I'm just glad it's over with, and I'm very happy. You know, I never thought I'd ever get 3,000 hits in my career, but, you know, I'm glad that's all over and done with. Now I can go home and get some sleep at nights. I was glad to come back home and do it, you know, also against the Twins, because that's where I got my first major league hit. And, you know, I'm sure that a lot of people back in the Twin Cities, you know, probably enjoyed it as much as I did.
Only the 16th player ever to reach 3,000 hits, Carew made his major league debut with the Twins in 1967. And, like Seaver, won his league's Rookie of the Year award that season. 2 years later, he captured the first of seven batting titles and began a string of 15 consecutive seasons in which he hit better than 300. His best year, 1977. He won the Most Valuable Player award and had a chance to become baseball's first 400 hitter since Ted Williams in 1941.
I think if it's possible that if I can get 2 good months back-to-back, anything can happen.
He ended up hitting .388, even though that year was a tough ordeal.
You know, in 1977, you know, when I was having such a good year and chasing that elusive 400 mark, as everybody talks about, I learned that it's one of the toughest things to cope with, because it hasn't been done for so many years. And wherever I went, you know, people are always there. There's always a camera there. I couldn't do anything. I kind of lost my privacy, you know, and I wasn't concentrating, you know, when I came out to play the game. And, you know, once you start doing things like that and getting away from the team effort instead of the individual thing, I think it can really hurt.
Minnesota fans suffered the hurt of Carew's loss in 79 when he was traded to California. Still a master of hitter's intuition, he batted over 300 five straight times, twice helping the Angels win division titles.
I can tell once a pitcher releases the pitch what it is. I am not a guess hitter. If a guy throws me a fastball and if I see it's coming in on the outside corner, I click in my mind that I want to hit the ball to left field. If it's a breaking ball that's going to be down and in, then I know that I want to try and pull the ball if I can. But I don't walk up there and guess at all. I just look for the baseball and try and put it in play.
Well, few big leaguers have ever done it any better than Rod Carew. Now, let's open the notebook for this week in baseball's Twib Notes from around the American League. Yankee veteran Phil Niekro hopes to join Tom Seaver in the magic circle of 300 game winners. He's just 6 victories away. Oakland's Don Sutton is also closing in. The leader among active pitchers in games started, he beat Seattle for career win number 290. Boston's Wade Boggs has been batting over 400 since mid-June and had a 28-game hitting streak, longest in the majors in 5 years. He got 4 hits against Kansas City to take over the league batting lead at .354, swinging for his second batting crown in 5 years. Perhaps only a full moon could account for a most bizarre play which occurred in a game between the White Sox and Yankees. With 2 men on in the bottom of the 7th inning, New York's Ricky Henderson came up with a score tied at 5-all. And here we go.
Salazar way back. He can't get it. Meacham went back in tag and stumbled.
a discombobulating double play. Seattle's Gorman Thomas is storming once again after missing most of last season with a shoulder injury. In 15 games, Thomas hit 10 homers for a total of 24 and 277 at-bats. Now that's an average of almost one home run every 11 times up. Now for this week's quiz, can you name the active major leaguer with the career best home run ratio? Stay tuned for a 400 home run man. National League highlights. A tale of two outstanding upstarts making their marks in the majors. St. Louis Roadrunner Vince Coleman made haste into the record books by breaking the Major League rookie mark for stolen bases when a flub by the Cubs turned a Cardinal double steal into a double-double steal, giving Coleman two stolen bases on the play and the record, 74. Philadelphia's Juan Samuel held the record when he stole 72 bases in 160 games as a rookie last year. But it took Coleman just 99 games to break that mark this year.
I just thank the Lord for giving me the ability and strength to go out and accomplish such goals. It's one thing is that I've been able to establish a stolen base record since I've been in professional baseball. And once I say that I reached the major league level, I try to maintain that status.
Coleman's also maintained an impressive .275 batting average.
I let my hitting dictate, you know, how often I get on base. And if I'm able to get on base, I think that I'm capable of stealing a base. I'm just thankful for my hitting, you know, that I'm able to get better contact now and concentrate more. And I think it's a matter of me maintaining consistency from day to day is to go out and, you know, make things happen.
Now, a young pitcher also making things happen. New York's Dwight Gooden made Met history the same day that former Met Tom Seaver won number 300. Gooden beat the Cubs for win number 11 in a row, breaking Tom Terrific's 16-year-old team record. That gave 20-year-old Dr. K a 17-3 mark with a Terrific 1.57 ERA.
If he continues the desire that he has to excel, and he really does have that. He wants to be as good as people think that he is. In fact, is even better. And he works very hard in between each start, so I just see him getting better and better. I don't know what the limit for Dwight Gooden is.
Next day, Darryl Strawberry made the sky the limit when he blasted three home runs against the Cubs and went 4-for-4 with five RBIs. The Straw not only broke Chicago's back in a 7-2 win, but powered the Mets to their ninth victory in 11 games as they charged into a tie for first place with St. Louis in the East. The Mets had even more to shout about later that day when Philadelphia's Ozzie Virgil used his clout to beat the slumping Cardinals with two home runs as St. Louis fell off the top of the heap for the first time since late June, giving the Mets first place all alone. And now, all systems go for Houston's top-flight Astro. Jose Cruz added his name to the Astro record books in a game against San Diego when he passed Cesar Cedeno to become Houston's all-time leader with 1,660 hits. A standout since coming from St. Louis 10 years ago, Cruz holds a flock of Astro career marks. He's hit 300 or better five times while driving in at least 90 runs each of the past 2 years. But despite these kinds of numbers, Jose Cruz does not get the raves he deserves.
I just wish that he'd gotten recognition that he deserves and that he would have had the opportunity to have a good hitter hitting behind him, because I think if he did, he would even be a better hitter than he is now.
God gave certain people great abilities and great bodies, and Cheo Cruz is one of them. He has good abilities, great abilities. Not only that, he has a great attitude. He loves to play the game, which is probably a main criteria for a guy that plays 15 to 16 years and continually does well. And you know, ever how old he is, nobody knows. He just keeps getting better and better and better. But Cheo is just a great guy.
Admired by teammates, but generally overlooked, Cruz made the All-Star game this year for just the second time.
It's about time that they select me for the All-Star. I think I deserve it. I deserve it just maybe 3 years back there. But I'm happy this year. I like, want to do my best.
38-year-old Cruz has been doing mighty fine for 15 seasons. And while a consistently tough customer at the plate, Cheo's hard work on defense has paid off in the outfield.
Cheo Cruz is probably the most amazing individual I've ever had a chance to meet. He's so much fun, you know, and on the field, you know, his numbers speak for itself, but he's such a character. He's got such a great personality. I don't think there's anything good that can be said about Jose that hasn't already been said.
Philadelphia's Mike Schmidt has won 7 home run titles while hitting 442 career homers and owns the best home run ratio of any active big leaguer with 1 homer nearly every 14 at-bats. By the way, Dave Kingman of Oakland is only percentage points behind Schmidt and only 1 home run shy of becoming the 21st player in Major League history to hammer 400 homers. Hey fans, looking like a million's not easy, but no need to worry. Big leaguers and their fans know it's not just how you play the game, but how you look playing it or watching it.
Saludos, my darlings, and you know who you are. Come on, let's mingle. So nice to see you. Throw your hips into the air like Sid Chorice and Fred Astaire. Let's crazy go now. Just looking into your eyes, darling, I can tell that you have the legs of a dancer. So bring those legs and the rest of your body over here and be Nando's private prancer. Darling, I got to tell you something. And I don't say this to everybody. You look marvelous. Absolutely. You know, my dear, my father used to say to me, Nando, don't be a schnook. It's not how you feel. It's how you look. He was marvelous. But you, darling, you look marvelous. Absolutely marvelous. And this is from my heart, which is deep inside my body. It's better to look good than to feel good. Get down.
Man alive, what can I say now except that was simply marvelous. And so are these headliners from the Big League Department of Defense, sending out flashes of daring deeds from the fielding front. Up first and out of the hot corner, Texas Ranger Steve Buschel. The Braves' Rafael Ramirez to Glenn Hubbard to Bob Horner for 2. Milwaukee's Paul Molitor. Toronto Blue Jay Garth Ord, down and dirty. Keith Moreland, Chicago Cubs on a roll. Cincinnati's Eddie Milner, rough and tumble. Milwaukee's Bobby Clark. Baltimore's Gary Renicky making a splash. Robin Yount, another Brewer. Harold Baines, White Sox. Phil Bradley, Seattle. George Vukovich, Cleveland. Terry Harper, Atlanta. And finally, hanging on for Baltimore, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mike Young. Now from great plays to great news. After a 2-day strike which interrupted 25 games of play, baseball is back.
There was integrity on both sides. We've been saying that for a long time, and that's why there's agreement today. Integrity. Some people have talked about my role. I want to you to know very clearly that I had no role, that this was done by these two teams of people headed by Don Fehr and Lee McPhail, and they put baseball back on the field.
The bargaining was hard, and we have an agreement that we hope will work, that we're going to do our best to make work over the next 5 years through the 89 season.
The commissioner did an excellent job of keeping things going. He did everything that a person could possibly do, interfering as little as necessary with the bargaining process and enabling us to reach an agreement.
Hi, Tom Bodette. This week, Old Spice salutes Rodney Klein Carew and George Thomas Seaver for their historic achievements.
You're a winner, that's what you are. Believe it or not, you know you're really a star. I'm so happy, there's a ring in your ears. People applaud, you've waited for years. You're a winner, whatever you do.
Heartiest congratulations, men. That's all for now, folks. See you next week on This Week in Baseball.